Good morning and welcome to everyone. And thank you for joining us this morning. And I see some of my friends on and I can't be any more happier. I am Elaine Morgan. I'm the CEO for the Berkeley Chamber. And I think that our activity with all of this is with our Berkeley Outreach Group that reaches out to all kind of different people in not only Berkeley County, but in the other two counties, trying to get more people to be inclusive and join different things. And I cannot tell you how thrilled I am to be the honor of working with the League of Women Voters of the Charleston area. It's just been such a great thrill for me. And for those who may not be as knowledgeable about our League Women, the League works at encouraging to inform people on government what the issues are, to get people more involved in voting and to educate on the voting issues. And for our guys, even though it is a League of Women, they will allow gentlemen to join. So do not feel left out. One of the reasons that we were looking at doing this, and both of our organizations are nonpartisan, okay? And even though some other chambers have PACs, our chamber does not do PACs. We do not endorse candidates, but we do, just like the League, we encourage informed voters, and we also encourage people to vote to register. So what we've been seeing is not as many people coming out to participate in the elections, voting, and even looking at being a candidate. So we're hoping that we can share information that will make that easier. And also that the information you could share with people and try to encourage them to look at running, because they, you know, the one thing we are blessed in the Little Country, we have great, great people. And so we'd love to see them get more involved with our government. Okay. The first portion of running for office is going to be with our voter registration directors, and I can't tell you how thrilled I am to see Kissy and Isaac on this morning with us. And it will be thank you for running for office. The questions, we'll put the questions. If you have any questions while they're speaking, please put it in the chat box and we'll answer that later. Finally, I'd like to cover just a few ground rules. If you're not a speaker, which please turn your video off and mute your speakers now. Questions from the audience, please put in the chat box and they'll be answered after that session. And remember, this is a nonpartisan event. And at this time, I am so thrilled to turn it over to one of my new best friends, Ms. Jennifer Mez. Jennifer.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for joining us. Well, as Lane said, we are happy to have Kizzy Scott and Isaac Kramer with us, missing Rosie Brown, but I'm sure Kizzy and Isaac can answer all of my questions and then later in the program, all of your questions. So with that, I'll be moderating the question and answer panel. So again, we have Isaac Kramer who is a Board of Elections Director for Charleston County, and Kizzy Scott, who's the Board of Elections Director for Dorchester County, on our panel today. I have a series of preset questions that I'll be asking the directors, and we'll, since it's just two of them now, we'll just flip-flop with your answers back and forth. We ask that all the participants please shut off your video and mute yourselves. I think it looks like on my screen, most people have already done that. And Kizzy and Isaac, just unmute yourselves and turn on your video and we'll get started. Okay. All right, question number one for Kizzy and Isaac: what is the best way to communicate with the Board of Elections as a candidate? So what are your office hours and who should I contact? Isaac, would you answer that first?
Yeah, definitely. Thanks for having me today, and just a great time to be thinking about running for office because we're about to come up to candidate filing for the primaries in June. So one of the ways you can communicate with our office in Charleston County is just coming into our office and meeting our staff, talking with them up front. And if you have any questions, you can do that. Another way, you can just call us 843-744-8683. And another tool we have is live chat. And you can go to our website, chsvotes.gov, and you can actually chat with somebody, one of your questions. You don't even have to pick up the phone. It's something unique only to Charleston County. And the other counties don't have that. So if you're running in Charleston County, that is a tool you can use. Also, you can use that anytime during the election season. You can use that with encouraging your voters to contact us to request a ballot. If they need to know where their polling location is, that's a great tool to use, especially when our phones are ringing off the hook during election time. But really, the communication is a two-way street. We're doing our best to put out the information that you need to file for office, any literature you need for getting your voters ready to vote before an election. And one thing I really would love for our candidates to do is be in a relationship that is not combative. And what I mean by that is a lot of times during election time, things are very stressful, they're tense, and people call us or email us and get very angry or upset about something. And it's usually just a misunderstanding of certain things going on. So please build a relationship with us, talk with us, be cordial, and we'll be showing that same respect to you. But if you're calling us on election day and you're yelling at us and saying we're doing all these things, that's when the relationship starts getting a little bit rocky, because we can't be in a million places at once. And we rely on information coming from our polling locations, from you. So if you just say, hey, you know, I noticed this was going on, just do that. Don't immediately jump to like 100 miles per hour with the conversation. So candidates, the best way to talk with us is definitely using the cordial route. And we will do the best to, you know, just answer questions that you may have.
Okay, thanks, Isaac. Kizzy, would you like to answer that question? Best way to communicate with the Board of Elections, the office hours, and who should a candidate contact? Kizzy, can you unmute yourself? Well, we'll continue on until we get Kizzy able to unmute and answer the question. I'll move on to question two for Isaac. What is the cost of candidate filing fees? Should they send a check? Can they use PayPal, credit card? What are your ways of accepting payment?
So the first thing you need to do is find out which office you're running for, because the filing fees will differ by office. We have a great resource on our website, chsvotes.gov, and it's actually candidate filing information, and it gives you all the filing fees for all the different offices in Charleston County. And each county does that as well, kind of sets either on their website or a way for you to download information on that. But typically those filing fees are gonna be, it's based on the salary of the office of January of each election year. And those fees are picked that way because it's 1% of it and it goes toward the primary. Now, if you're running for a non-primaried office, for example, school board in Charleston County, you don't need to pay a filing fee. But the filing fee goes to the state parties and it's paid for by three different ways. There's check, there's money order, and cashier's check. There's no other way. You can't bring money, like cash, into our office. We don't do PayPal. There's only three ways: check, money order, cashier's check. And if you show up to our office and it's not Like if you come with a cashier's check at 11:59 on the last day of filing and it's not made out to the right entity, I'm sorry, you have to have everything completed when you're filing for office. So if you have to run down to the Food Lion or Western Union, it's too late when you're up against the deadline. So be prepared. Know that those are the three different things. And on our website, we have it laid out really well where you can see all the filing fees for the different offices, and it has to be exact. So don't come in with $10 or, something like that. So we just encourage you to be informed before you come into the office, because it does matter, especially when we get to the end of candidate filing, and it might be difficult for you if you have it. So it's either the state Democratic Party or the state Republican Party if you're running for a partisan office and that has a primary. If you don't, good news. There's no filing fee in Charleston County. You just fill out a statement of intention candidacy form, and it's that easy.
Great. Okay. Thank you. All right. It appears that Kizzy was having connection issues, so she has had to log off. And Will, if she's able to log back on, I'll go backwards and ask her the same question, so everybody gets the feedback from Dorchester County when she's back with us. So moving on, Isaac, State Election Commission can provide candidates with what kind of information, and as opposed to what the county board of elections can provide? What are the different?
Great question. And this is actually one of the questions that we get a lot during the candidate filing season and also heading to an election. People want to get the list of registered voters in the district they're representing. We cannot provide that at the county office. You have to purchase that with the State Election Commission. Now, every other sort of information you would want, either entity can do. So you could call the state and say, what's the data for Charleston County in 2018 in District 7? They can provide that data of like just numbers. We do that as well. So for the county office, we can provide turnout data. We can provide maps if you need that. We can provide you any of the resources for poll worker handbook. So if you want to know what the do's and don'ts are on election day, we can give you a copy of that handbook. It's also online on sevotes.gov. So really, we can help guide you to the right place to get, information. But if you want to purchase a list, that is the State Election Commission. If you want to know how many people live in your district, we can give that easily. But once you get to the actual names of registered voters and when they voted, that's a purchased list. And we don't have control over that at the county level. Also, the Charleston County Board of Elections, and I would say for all the elections offices in the state, our goal is to try to provide as much information as possible to you. So if you just have general questions, just about anything in the election process, we're going to answer that. So absentee ballots, voter registration questions, photo ID, just give us a call and we're going to help you through that.
Okay. So basically the candidates should stick with asking you guys first before the SEC. Start at the county level.
Unless it's purchasing a list. If you want a list of voters, go straight to the state. Don't call us, because that's just, I don't want to have your time wasted by, us just pointing you to the State Election Commission.
Okay. Next question. What type of information does the Ethics Commission, State Ethics Commission, collect and manage related to candidates and then those who are then voted into office?
So this question is an interesting one, because over 10 years ago, the State Ethics Commission, before you did it all with our office, and then there was a switch, the Ethics Commission actually separated that responsibility. So when you file for office at our at Charleston County or Dorchester or Berkeley, you will file, and then we will give you information on then filing your ethics report with the Ethics Commission, and they do it all online. So you have to go to their website. I'm going to use that as a resource, because we are not the experts in that. And we've been told we don't want to be, responsible for providing incorrect information. And so sc.ethics.gov, that's where you want to head to. Actually, I might have given you the wrong but it's, let me, sorry, ethics. It's ethics.sc.gov. And you'll go there and you're going to be required to file your economic interest and a report of your, you know, I believe it's once you raise $500, you need to file your report, but also as running for office, you need to file. We get that question a lot, but we always refer people to contact the Ethics Commission, because at the end of the day, they're the ones responsible for that. And then after you're elected, they have a series of quarterly reports, but that's all done online. And we will give you that information when you file. Previously, they've given us like a handout flyer. We'll hand it to you when you file, and then you just use that to file with them.
Okay, that's good information. It's probably something that the candidates may not have thought of at this point, or people potentially, potential candidates who are on our call today.
Yeah, you don't want to delay with that either, because you will get fined for not meeting the deadlines and requirements with the Ethics Commission. And quite frankly, with a lot of the stuff going on with ethics in the state of South Carolina, I think they are looking at what to do with people who have not paid ethics fines. And it might eventually get you kicked off the ballot or kick you out of office if you haven't paid back. So, but that's all with them. We're going to do our best to help guide you. But when it comes to the actual filing and how to do all the mechanics of that, that will be out of our kind of jurisdiction.
Okay, thanks, Isaac. The next question, this is sort of a general question. What is your advice to candidates who are, I think we should pose the question, candidates who are thinking about running, candidates who have committed to run, and candidates after, or on election day. You did touch a little bit on the election day part and the phone calling, so how about each step of the way, what would be your advice?
I mean, the first thing, know where you're running for. So, you know, if you've made that decision, I'm running, and I'm just going to use an example. I'm going to run for State House of Representatives. Be familiar with what your filing fee is. Be familiar with who you're running as, a Republican, a Democrat, a Green Party, Working Families, any one of the parties that you want to run as. You got to have that figured out before you file, because you got to have that in the paperwork. But then the next step, getting the Ethics Commission, making sure you are all up to date with that. And then as we head into the primary season, you know, the best thing for you as a candidate is engage with the people that will be voting. And a lot of times we get the questions like, you know, can I do this? Can I not do that? Can I do this? Well, we do have something on the website about candidates' do's and don'ts. So it's kind of a quick little resource for you, what you can and can't do as a candidate. But really, at the end of the day, it's you're relying on us to conduct the election. So knowing that we have absentee voting, and that might actually change if you've been paying attention to the current legislation that's going through the It went through the House this week, 114-0 for early voting. So we might have a law change. So staying up to date on that. The next thing is redistricting. I guess we didn't really talk about that, but we're going to have new districts in Charleston County. Over 200,000 registered voters are affected by redistricting. So making sure that you know the area you're representing is really important. Because if you're telling candidates, I'm running in, you know, I'm going to say State House 115, well, that district's actually moved significantly. So making sure you're actually reaching the right voters and not, you know, maybe misinforming people like you live in 115 when they actually live in a different district. We're going to do our best to inform candidate or voters about their redistricting. We're going to send them the information in the mail and also do a really big media blitz to let people know, go to sevotes.gov and check your districts. They've changed, most likely. The other thing, and it goes back to the first thing, build a good relationship with our office. I remember last year in 2021, you know, we had candidates call us on election day and they had questions. The general, you know, they weren't attacking or yelling. They'd say, hey, I noticed that there are a bunch of people, you know, at the road waving signs. Is that okay? And that was a very good conversation. And I said, yes, that is okay, because they're outside of the 200 feet. Once it's outside of 200 feet, we don't have jurisdiction over. Now, if they're causing a traffic hazard, that's something you would we need to contact the police about, because we don't want to have an accident or anything. But once it goes outside of 200 feet, we don't have control over that. And it was just a nice conversation. Now, if things are happening that are not going well, like there are candidates, staff or volunteers inside the polling location or within the 200 feet, soliciting votes, like actual representatives, not the actual candidate, then we can handle that and just call us and let us know that information. So just building a relationship is important, because we need to know what's going on in the field. If you have concerns, you have questions, it's just good to have. And lastly, I would just say my advice would be, there's going to be a winner and there will be a loser. And that, I say that because it's important to know that in elections, we're going to have a winner. So someone is going to end after certification is going to be nominated. They're just going to have the seat, whatever it is. And there's gonna be a loser. And the loser, and I know I don't like losing. Whenever I play board games or sports, I don't like losing. But you always ask, why did I lose? And a lot of times people look at the office of the Board of Elections and say, well, you did this and the machines are rigged and all these people couldn't vote. They immediately go to that point. And I would just ask that this election, with such the heatedness around the topic, that if you lose, the first thing is you didn't get enough votes. That would be the number one thing. You didn't get enough votes. And if you won, congratulations. And that'll be exciting. I would just be prepared as a candidate. Always prepare that you might lose, no matter who you are. You might be an incumbent. You might have run before, but you need to be prepared in elections to potentially lose. And that's just part of the process. And you know what? Maybe in 2 years, you run again and you win. Some people, they run for the first time and they would have done something differently. Maybe they would have targeted, more of the absentee vote and done more mailers, or they might have campaigned more, gone to more events. So there are always rooms of improvement, and maybe, the next time you will win. So that would be my advice to you as a candidate. Maybe expect to lose and maybe expect to win, and you just have that in the back of your mind.
Thank you. That's important advice to everyone on this call. I see that Kizzy Scott may be with us. Kizzy, are you able to use your audio and answer questions yet? Okay, well, Kizzy seems to still be having some connection issues.
You're stuck with me.
Yeah. Well, thanks, Isaac, for hanging in there by yourself. All right, we'll move on to another question and hope Kizzy can join us. This is a four-part question, so let's just kind of go back and forth. What are the candidates' role at the polls? And you did touch a little bit on this. What kind of campaign signage is allowed? Where can they stand? Where do their campaign workers? What can they do? So sort of election day information, do's and don'ts.
Yeah. So this is the hot button question. So we're going to stop and let's look at first who makes our laws. They're elected officials who are also candidates. So we always get people, and these are not necessarily candidates or elected officials, but a lot of times we get voters call us, say, I don't think so-and-so should be allowed inside the polling location, shaking hands, greeting people at the door kind of thing. Well, that's actually permissible under the law. So candidates, you can actually stand and be stationed in a polling location outside the door, and you can actually greet voters and you can solicit votes, provided, now here's the key one, you're not impeding in the voting process. You're not actually disrupting anything. And once we get complaints from voters, we'll contact you and say, hey, we're getting complaints. you're going to need to move yourself. So granted, there are no complaints from voters. You're allowed to be outside the polling location at the door, shaking hands, introducing yourself, soliciting, saying, vote for me. You're allowed to do that. But once you're inside the polling location, things change a little bit as a candidate. And the last thing with that, you have to have a name badge that you are the candidate and what office you're running for. That's four. It's on a 4.25 by 4.25 badge. So no larger than that. You can have smaller. You can have a teeny one or a 4.25 by 4.25. But once you're inside the polling location as a candidate, you can go inside. You have to remove that badge and you can't actively campaign in the polling location, but you're allowed to be in there. You can say hello to people, but you can't actually solicit and, have that badge on. That's the number one thing we get from candidates not realizing they can do that. And it's actually an important thing you can do. If you know your precinct is heavily turned out area, you can go to that location and actively campaign at the door, shaking hands, saying hello. Now, if someone complains and we get that information, we will address that. We're not going to say, you're kicked out and have police show up. We'll give you a call and say, hey, we're getting, complaints from some voters. It's a good idea. You need to leave the door. You can still be at the polling location. And then the next question about, or continue with the roll, you can look at the voter registration list. So you can actually go to the check-in station and you say, I want to see the list of people who voted already. You're allowed to do that. That's important. That's not just poll watchers. Actual candidates can go in and say, I want to look at the polling list. The next question was, what kind of campaign signage? So outside of 200 feet, you can have as many signs as you want. As much as you want, you can line up the whole road with signs as long as it's outside 200 feet. Like I said, candidates have to have the name badge on that they are the candidate, but they can't be passing out literature. You can't have that. You can't, technically, you're not even supposed to have bumper stickers or signs in your window, anything of that. Once it's 200 feet from the entrance of the polling location. Another thing it is, and I know that this is stating the obvious, but you can't procure votes by threatening people and intimidating people, mistreating people, or paying somebody to vote for you. You can't promise money. I know that I'm saying that because that's the law, but you'd be surprised. There are people who say, I will give you X for voting for me. That is unlawful. Just remember, it's private property most of the places you go vote, so be respectful of the areas outside the 200 feet. This goes back to advice. We want to be good stewards and then be respectful of people's property. Normally you'll see signs lining up an area on election day. Probably a good idea to remove those signs at the end of the night after the election's over. I think that's just a good practice. We don't control signage. That's another question we get, like, what are the laws for signs in this area? Well, we're not the jurisdiction over that. When it comes to like putting a yard sign in your yard or lining up an area, that's the municipalities ordinances, and they all differ. So just letting you know about that. So what about you send over some, volunteers to do a sign wave or do things like that. Once again, outside 200 feet, you can wave signs, you can do all of that and have a good time with that. But once you're inside 200 feet, you can't be passing out literature. You can't have campaign signage. And lastly, this is something that we've, as the Charleston County Board of Elections, have really asked, is instead of being a poll watcher, be a poll worker. And I think a lot of candidates, they will try to get as many poll watchers as possible, which is great. That's part of the election process. But also know that we need people, good people, to work the polls as paid workers who follow the laws and guidelines that we are talking about right now. So I go to a lot of little political events. I go to, you know, Democratic Party, Republican Party, civic groups, League of Women Voters. We talk about poll workers. You know, these are people that are paid and working long days and hours. And I would say that a lot of them, they do it once and they're unappreciated. And as a candidate, if you are attacking a poll worker or you have staff that are attacking poll workers, like verbally making them feel less than dirt, they're never going to work again. And also, they're actually technically my staff and they're working for me. So I'll have a problem with that. And I'll let you know, I'll say, hey, I've heard that these people are berating my clerk. You know, we need, that's unacceptable. These people are being, they're workers. They're actually working. They're not trying to go one way or the other. They're doing the best they can following the law. So we need to respect the poll workers at the locations. Yeah, that's, there's a lot more. I would recommend, honestly, that you download the poll manager's handbook, and you're going to see a lot more in there, kind of giving you the process of election day. And the same applies to absentee voting, or if we go to early voting, the same restrictions on 200 feet, all of that still apply. Those are polling locations as well.
Okay, I have two quick follow-up questions along those lines. Can candidates distribute water and food at the polls? That's kind of a hot button media issue this year. And also, Isaac, you mentioned the candidate, the campaigns possibly applying to have poll watchers. Is there a limit to the number of poll watchers at each precinct?
Yeah. So first question about food and water. That is a hot button. The law, every election we have people passing out food and water at our polling locations. And as long as it's not voting for somebody, you're not soliciting votes through giving water and food. We have a lot of volunteers who do that, especially standing in line for a long time. And if it's hot, you know, we're not going to turn those people away. The area of concern here is what constitutes soliciting votes for these items. And that's where it gets murky. So a lot of times we have nonpartisan groups doing this. Like we had pizza to the polls in 2020. They literally had just pizza boxes, no affiliation with anybody. So this is where I would say you're risking something by doing that. And this is, once again, I'm not a campaign manager. I'm not here to give political advice, but the appearance could look really bad with some people, some voters. You might turn people away by doing that. It might be best to go with a nonpartisan group who might provide those things. And there'll be plenty of them, especially in 2022, there'll be a lot of groups who are gonna wanna help with food and water. And then your question about the poll watchers, and I'm going to pull this up because I do not want to misspeak. Poll watchers, it varies. Just came out of municipal elections, so I don't want to say the wrong thing. Just give me 1 second. All right. So in party primaries, each candidate may appoint one watcher at a time for any polling location that candidate's name is on the ballot. Okay, so in June, you can appoint one person, anybody, you know, in that specific polling location where your name is on the ballot. So if I'm running, for example, for County Council 4, I can't have a poll watcher for me in a location where I'm not on the ballot in a different part of the area. So that's that clarification. And then in a general election, so if you're running as a Republican, Democrat, Green, Libertarian, watchers are appointed by the party, not the candidate. That's in a general election. So in the primary, the candidate can appoint somebody. And then in the general election, it's got to be the actual political party will appoint somebody, not the candidate. Candidates of the same political party political party are jointly represented at a polling location, and you're not allowed to have more than two watchers for each 1,000 registered voters. So that's going to require some math. So some precincts you might have multiple, like for example, you might have multiple precincts in one polling location. And if there's 3,000 registered voters there, you would be able to have six poll watchers. So it's one that you can have two per 1,000 for a party. Hope everyone's staying with me. This is also in the poll workers handbook. So you can see that. That's what I'm saying. It's a good resource. It's a lot coming at you. But in a general election, your political party is going to be the one sending the poll watcher on your behalf. So I can tell you that we have this every election. The parties are well aware of how it works. So if you're concerned about an area, you can talk to your political party and say, hey, I would like to have a watcher there. They'll be the one who does that. Lastly, nonpartisan candidates. So if you're nonpartisan, you're not running in June. So your school board, soil and water, your public service districts, don't worry about June. Let's talk November, because you're not going to have a June primary. When you do have a poll watcher, you can appoint one watcher at a time. So you can have one person. And for nonpartisan candidates, you got one person that you appoint for that location. There isn't even more than that. I know it's confusing. I know it's a lot of information. And a lot of candidates might not even be aware of that, what I just said. You know, I can have a poll watcher if I'm nonpartisan in the general election. Yes, you can have one. And it's also important that you're going to have, they're going to have a letter, and they're going to present that letter to the clerk, and you'll have a badge like candidates do that's not going to exceed 4 1/4 by 4 1/4. And it's going to be on there, and it's going to tell you who you are. And sorry, excuse me. Still early morning. My coffee's still kicking in. But we do ask you as a poll watcher, you know, you can't interfere with any of the process still. You can't be disorderly. We're also doing voting. So like you can't interrupt the voting process. You can't do that. You got to be respectful. Now, if a clerk is not treating you with respect, we want to know about that. I want to know about that, by the way. So if you have somebody who's treating you bad, like in a disrespectful way at the polling location as a poll watcher or a candidate, please let me know. But don't call me and say, just talk to me, because I don't know the issue. First of all, you know, that's it a lot of times. People think we know everything. We have in Charleston County over 100 polling locations across 1,400 square miles, diverse areas with many different groups of people. Think about that. On election day, we have over 1,500 workers from all different backgrounds, all different areas. And it's hard for people to realize, like, I don't know it. Like, I don't know every single person that's, you know, we train them, they take a test. But if you don't call me and just say, hey, there's this issue going on, Isaac, can we look into that? Can you address that? We will do that. That goes a long way over than picking up the phone and saying, blank, 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 you blank, blank, these people are blank. You know, it's like, okay, well, you know, you've now lit the match over gasoline fire, and we're, you know, you blew it up. So just remember, we're not there at the polling location. We can address those things, and we will find out what's going on. So as a poll watcher, remember, respect is key, and knowing that you can't interfere with the voting process. You're not being paid as a poll worker. You're there to observe. You're there to make sure everything is going right. You're there to ensure that the voting process is going smoothly and in a way that is free and fair. Really, at the end of the day, free and fair elections. You're making sure those things are happening. And that's what distinguishes us from so many other countries, is that we have this ability for people to observe. So those are good questions, and they're the hardest ones on election day. Managing all those different things is difficult, because you have so many different personalities of candidates, volunteers, poll watchers, poll workers, and then we got voters. It's great. We love election day.
Great, thanks, Isaac. We're gonna have one final question, and then I'll ask you to have any other thoughts or advice. Let's talk about independents. Do they have a primary? Do they have to petition to run? Do they need signatures on that petition? What do we do about independents?
Yeah, what do we do? So Yeah, this is tricky because some people, you know, they want to run for office, but they don't align with either political party. And we don't have an independent political party in South Carolina. We have an independence. But if you read into that, it's not independent. It doesn't mean you're in the middle of the road. They actually have ideologies that are not what you would view as an independent. So a lot of people come in and say, I want to run if, you know, as independent. Well, unfortunately, you can't. You have to run as a petition candidate. And petition candidate is very difficult in South Carolina with offices that exceed, like when we think congressional, state house, state senate, U.S. Senate, governor. Those are difficult to run petitions because you're running across multiple counties, multiple districts, and you're going to need 10,000 plus signatures in those areas of registered voters, not just of any people. You need registered voters. But if you want to run as a petition candidate, it's 5% of the area you're representing. They have to be registered voters, and it's based on the voter registration population of 120 days prior to the election. The local offices, they can have different, you know, when we're talking about municipal elections or referendum, it's usually 15%, but it can differ. But if you want to be a candidate who runs as a petition candidate, we just ask that you call us and get those qualifications from us for the specific office you are running for. It has to be on specific paper, and we will link you with all of those resources. So remember how we said, have good communication with the office. If you want to run as a petition candidate, it would be best to call us immediately so we can start you down that road. With a petition candidate, your filing deadline is July 15th at noon. That's an important date. We do not accept petitions after July 15th at noon. And then it depends how many petitions we have to go through. It could take 2 to 3 weeks to review the petitions. And then we will let you know, did you get on the ballot? We have a deadline of August 15th to get all that done. So we have a tight window from that filing deadline. Before, school board had to run as petition candidate in Charleston County. And now we only have to file with a sheet of paper for the statement of intention to candidacy. So if you want to run as an independent, you're gonna have to run as a petition candidate. And that deadline is July 15th at noon. You have to have the petition forms on the specific size. And we'll get you that. We'll send you the link with that form. You can go and we can give you one copy, and then you can go make, you know, 100 copies at Staples or something. But just want to say, with this specific office of petition, you will be seen as petition on the ballot. You're going to have, I believe in 2014, the governor's election, then we did have a petition. I think it was Irwin or somebody like that. He ran as petition against Haley and I believe Shaheen. But when he was on the ballot, it was his name, and then it said PET. And that means he was a petition candidate. So it's really important that when you're doing that process, you're looking to make sure the people that are signing your petition give as much information as possible. There's a line for their name, so printed name, and their signature. Now, the law that all requires is that part, but you know how difficult it would be to verify a John Smith in Charleston County when there's probably 500 of them. It's very difficult. So there's a spot for their address and their date of birth and voter registration number. The more information that is filled out on that petition is going to make your life easier too, because you're going to know, is that person registered? Because you can actually look them up. Or, you know, how many, do they even live in Charleston County or Berkeley County or Dorchester County? You want to make sure that those people signing that form are registered voters, because when you submit that at, you know, up at the last minute, there's no, you can't go and amend your petitions. So if you don't have enough signatures, or if you just give us the minimum, if you give us the minimum amount of signatures required, I'm probably going to tell you that that wasn't smart because you're going to need more than that. People say, well, how many signatures should I have if the minimum is 1,000? I mean, I would probably do 10% plus, but I'm not a political advisor. You might give us bad signatures, you know, registered, you know, they might not be registered. So you have to do what you're comfortable with, but I would go above the minimum requirement by a significant amount so that covers you in case some of these people are not registered or, you know, we've had issues where a husband signs a wife's name. But yeah, we can go all on about petitions. It's fun, but
thanks, remember, Isaac.
Contact us.
That's good. I learned a lot. I didn't know about the independent side. We're going to have to move on in our program. Thank you, Isaac, for carrying the all the answers to all our questions. I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Jerry Cabot.
All right. Good morning. I hope everyone can hear me. I had a little bit of technical difficulties before, but I'm back and I'll be helped with my PowerPoint today. So let's go ahead and get started with the PowerPoint.
Whoops, just a minute. Wait just a minute.
All right. Well, I'll spend while Paula is getting that ready. Let me just say a little bit about myself. So I live in Mount Pleasant, been in South Carolina for over 30 years, just retired from the College of Charleston, and my PhD is in political science. So I have been teaching American government, media and politics, parties and elections for many, many years, but preparing this particular presentation, I wanted to back up and I wanted to help individuals who are actually thinking about running go through a series of questions to, you know, that they would ask themselves as they ponder that question, and then also you know, help you understand where the resources are. So let's go ahead, Paula, to the next slide. Look at this number. Look at all the offices that are elected in the United States of America. It is unbelievable. In fact, political scientists have long talked about voter fatigue in the United States, that we have so many elected offices that sometimes our lower turnout could be in part because of so many offices on the ballot. And let me repeat again, this presentation is really geared for those thinking about running for the first time or coming back to run. Let's go ahead to the next slide. A little bit of humor there. I have some cartoons sprinkled through the presentation. Yes, you know, we turn around and again, there are the signs for candidates. We're already seeing them for the primary in South Carolina. Let's go ahead. So here's the flow. Spend some time asking you to think about what you care about. Then also talk a little bit about some of the regs. Some will touch on what Isaac just said, then some of the fundamentals, just a brief introduction on what does it mean to build a team? How do you think about fundraising? And then I give you a list of resources at the end. So let's go ahead. So which office should I run for? What should I do to get started? These are the basic questions. Let's go ahead to the next slide. Now, in some ways you want to think impact. Where can I have impact? Maybe you want to start local. You know, I've thought about this myself, you know, working at the college for so many years. Let me give you an example. I worked with students, local police, city officials, and the people I worked with at the college in managing our students in the downtown area. Well, you know who was missing at that table all the time were the landlords. So I thought to myself, and I looked around at what other cities are doing. They have a long-term landlord licensing. So let's say I was interested in bringing that issue to the table. Well, I would have to run, and I couldn't, but let's say I lived in the city of Charleston, I would have to run for the city council to make an impact on that issue, because the city manages landlords' property within their city boundaries. So you want to think first, what do I want to change? What do I care about that I think I can have some change on? Okay, let's go ahead. So don't do, you know, at some point, I hope it's today, maybe soon, you want to ask yourself these questions. You know, you want to spend some time in a room by yourself and say, what am I concerned about? What gets me mad, sad, disappointed? What do I notice on my way as I navigate my community? What issues do you want to turn to your family at some point in time and said, you know, I worked hard to make a change in that area? Or also think about, who do you respect? Who's making the kind of change and working the way you would want to work? And what position does that person have? Those are all questions that should get you started. Then as we go to the next slide, you don't have to know everything. Let me back up. Let me go here. Run for Something is an organization that's been preparing young people to run under 35 to get them involved in electioneering. And they say there are three fundamental questions you should ask yourself as you consider this. Why do I want to run? Or what is the problem I want to solve? How is the office I want to run for going to give me the space to solve that problem? And the last one, why voters should want me to win. So again, spend some time thinking about those questions sometime soon. Going on to the next slide, you don't have to know everything before you run. You don't have to be rich. You have to care about something, because it's that passion that's going to carry you through the entire election cycle. Next slide. Another reason to think about running is to represent the underrepresented. Think about, as Isaac was just telling us, there aren't many independents who make it onto the ballot. Maybe you want to represent those people who don't find themselves falling into either of our major parties. As he said, it's difficult to get on the ballot. And historically, the two parties have done that. But maybe you're motivated because you want to be that person around the table. Who's underrepresented? It doesn't take much to think about this. Working class people, renters, people of color, LGBTQ+. There are a lot of members of our community who are underrepresented. So that might be a motivation to run. Let's go to the next slide. As you make this decision, create a vision board. Think about that. If you had to put up all the words and the pictures that captured your political vision, what would be on your vision board? What would it look like? Short-term and long-term. Don't forget, you might decide not to run an immediate cycle, maybe a few years off as you get your feet wet. So think short-term and long-term. Never forget your why. What is your brand? What would be on your campaign sign? What would be your brand? And then once you make that decision, carry it with you. Take a sticky from your vision board, a picture, whatever. Put it in your car, your home, your office, your workout space, wherever you work, whatever. Remind yourself why you want to engage in political action. All right, then you got to start doing some research. The basics. Do I qualify for this position? You know, what are the qualifications? What about age, residency, criminal history, other aspects of the position you are considering? And the state of South Carolina has websites that have all the listing of the qualifications per position. The other thing you have to think about is in an open seat or not. If this is a partisan race, is it an open seat or not? Who's going to be your likely competitors? And how will that impact the race? Going to the next slide. Then going the other direction, we went backwards a little bit. So next slide. And I really appreciate your help, Paula. This is fantastic. So think about your audience and ways you can get to know who's in your area are, as Isaac said, look at the election results. You can get the election results. You can get the results per precinct. So Charleston County has that data for you. And then also you can go to the recent census and you can look up all different dimensions of the area that you live in: income level, race, education level, age. You need to know your audience, who has the potential to elect you to a particular office. And these two resources are fantastic for helping you get a picture of who lives with you. Next slide. All right. Talk to those who have won and those who have lost. And ask yourself, how comfortable are you making these phone calls? Can you call up someone who's currently in office or someone you know who didn't win the last election? Ask them questions. What was their day-to-day like? How much did they campaign? How did it impact their personal lives? Was it a partisan race? Make sure you take notes. But there's nothing, I can't encourage you enough just to get on the phone, get on the Zoom, whatever. If you know somebody close enough, sit down, have a coffee, and just ask them some basic questions. All right, let's go to the next slide. Get the maps. Know your area. Again, the state provides this information. So does the county, so do the city. So you can literally see what precincts fall into the district that you're interested in. And there's really no reason not to do this kind of groundwork, because you'll be ahead of the game. You'll be way ahead of the game if you know the parameters, the basic geographic and demographic barriers, parameters, I should say, that you're working with. On to the next slide. Now it's time to, you've done a little bit of work, talk to some people. Now it's time to sit around that kitchen table and talk to your family. Are they ready, or friends? Are they ready for this run? And what kind of feedback will they give you? What kind of support will they give you? Keep in mind that jumping into a campaign rarely fits comfortably into your family schedule. So you're going to have to think hard how this will impact your day-to-day life and those in your family and close to you. Next slide. You may have to ask your boss. If you work for a city, county, state, maybe even some private employers want to know. If you're interested in running for an office, you might have to get permission from them. So plan to incorporate that into your thinking. Also, you know, many positions, you'll see the range of salaries coming up on a slide, but many positions don't pay that much. So the time you're spending giving your time to the public, how will that impact your financial resources, and can you afford it? Let's go to the next slide and look at some filing fees. Now, you can see, as Isaac told you, they vary by position. I just pulled Berkeley County out as one example, and you can see the range there. You can see the wide range in salaries and filing fees. So the higher the salary, the higher the filing fee. But think about that. If you're pondering county supervisor in Berkeley, you have to come up with over $7,000 just to file to run for that office. And then I have in the red box there some other examples, Charleston and Mount Pleasant for their town council, city council was a lower filing fee. So it varies. It varies. So that's something you have to consider right up front, the availability of funds to pay for that filing fee. Then to the next slide. The state of South Carolina also requires that you file personal financial information at the time you file for your candidacy. And so you got to ask yourself, how comfortable are you with having this information public? Because it does become public information. And it's not only financial information about yourself, but your family as well. So members of your family. And you can, I know the text is small and you'll have time to read it later. And the form is available clearly for all the counties and many websites, but you are spending some time giving a lot of personal financial information about yourself. And this is to prevent conflict of interest. So understand that that will be required. And it must be completed too. On to the next slide. Just some some examples of compensation. Wide variety, and the smaller text there is about the state house. You know, whether you're in the House of Representatives or the Senate. You know, the base salary is $10,400, but when you add up all the ancillaries, yes, the annual amount of money that could be accumulated could be much more. But again, you need to balance this against the funds you need to, and your family to just live your life. So keep these amounts in mind. And sometimes if you're thinking about, for example, the Edisto Beach Council, it's passion. It's wanting to give back to your community more than compensation. Let's go to the next slide. Now you got to think about how your personal story will play. It's prudent for you to think about anything in your past or the recent present, actually, that could be discovered. So stop and think about that as you recall your own journey. And how have those experiences shaped your passion? Also, how will your family handle coming into the campaign orbit? That's on the next slide. I'm sorry, Paula. I should have asked you to advance the slide. So again, just to repeat myself, how will your personal journey play? How will you tell your story? Sometimes it's called the elevator pitch plus your personal journey. Let's go on to the next slide. And then today, of course, you cannot think about running for office without thinking about, is there an old tweet out there, an old photo, something, an old blog, something I should be aware of? I used to talk to our students at the College of Charleston hours about this, about how things on the internet don't go away. But what consultants have said to candidates is voters will forgive a lot as long as you're willing to acknowledge it, be authentic about it. And maybe you need to incorporate it into your story. Lies, tend to come back to haunt you. And of course, the bottom line is, if this stuff doesn't impact how you will govern or how you will participate, say that and move on. Next slide. Insurance. It is very prudent for you to sit down with your insurance agent and say, tell me about, if I make the decision to run, is there anything that will cover me if I put my foot in my mouth or if somebody attacks me? What kind of coverage do I need? So take some time, sit down with your insurance provider and just ask some basic questions about should you run as you're considering this run for political office. And then the next slide is just some little bit of humor. As we all know, election season tends to correspond with Halloween. And this is just somebody making a joke about taking advantage of canvassing. Going to the next slide, as Isaac said, you know, the parties carry a lot of weight of campaigns, not only in South Carolina, but across the country. And so if you belong to a political party, you might want to sit down with somebody from your county committee and talk about a candidacy. How will they help you? What's the historical data they can give you? What about voter contact information? And what about volunteers? Or can you connect again with somebody you respect and talk to that person? Would they be willing to give you advice or even an endorsement? But the bottom line here is you better connect to the party. You know, you better show up to their events and demonstrate that you understand what their platform and issue positions are, and that you're willing to be a worker for them, as well as asking them to work for you. How do you get noticed by the party is by showing up for events and contributing to their efforts and to help out other candidates on other elected officials. Let's go to the next slide. And some races are, of course, the next slide is about nonpartisan. You know, here's a basic definition of what is nonpartisan. But we're all living through an area, an era too, where there's been a nationalization of local politics. And that's why I picked this cartoon. So even though you might be running for school board, waterworks, whatever, city council, there's no doubt that some of the issues at the national level are coloring the debates at the local level. Be prepared, know where you stand, just respond authentically. Going to the next slide. Very basics on building that team. As you're sitting around the kitchen table, who can you trust? Who's that circle of people you can tap to help you? And there's a lot of things that they can do. Who could you send out to help you raise money that you know could speak on your behalf? So what networks do you have that you could tap, that you could go to? You know, is it your bowling league or a church event? Or just think about your networks, who it is. When you think about a basic team for a campaign, we're usually talking about a campaign manager, a volunteer coordinator, somebody to deal with the finances. But there are a lot of other tasks to do. But you'll find that even for people who are running for local offices, it's them. They are the campaign team. And they are devoting themselves to trying to get elected to office. But SC Women Lead, which is an organization trying to get women into appointed positions and elected positions, they have compiled a fantastic list of consulting firms by their base city and specialization. So if you think you're going to raise the funds or you're going to lend yourself the funds to hire a consultant, start with that list. Look them over, look at their specialties and see if you need that kind of help and can afford it. All right, let's go to the next slide. I'll try to get through, speed it up a bit here. Before you begin your race, think about the number of people you need to vote for you. Now, of course, you got to think about what election cycle you're in. Are you in a primary or are you in a general election? How many voters do you need to get to either maybe even get to a runoff or to get through the primary? And to the next slide, the American majority has a nice workbook where if you can get the data, you can plug it into their formulas to give you a ballpark figure on what you need as a win number and a vote goal. But keep in mind, given that we went through redistricting, or we haven't finished completely yet, but we're redistricting, that will change. When you go back to look at historical data, make sure you got the right precincts in the district that you're looking at as you look at election returns. So these calculations can be correct, but they have a whole workbook and they have even how to make these calculations per precinct. So I recommend that you look at it. Let's go to the next slide. Thinking about cost, you could go back and look at what has been expended in previous campaigns. It's all out there, it's public information. Now again, the boundaries may change for you, but you can go to the state election board and say, you know, where are the figures? What did people spend before? Look at winners, of course, as much as you can to get a sense of how much you think you need to raise and how much you are likely to spend. If we go to the next slide, of course, learn the money rules. As Isaac said, you're going to have to know these rules. He's not going to be the one to answer them for you. You're going to have to go to the state. There's going to be filing periods, but all that information is out there. In fact, the state does a great job of creating a calendar and what forms need to be filed by when. So there's really no excuse not to know, but know before you make your commitment so you understand whether it's going to be yourself or somebody helping you, how they need to stay on top of these money rules and having a checking account ready to go. The next slide is about fundraising and just the basics. Fundraising can make the difference between winning and losing, but you know, it's going to be you. It's just going to be you asking others. You know, I went to a workshop, they had a great exercise. They had all of us just explain our first names. Where did our first names come from? What do we think about our first names? And you would be surprised. Just that sort of conversation relaxes you. It's about you. It's about you and how you present yourself to others. Those sort of exercises are very valuable because it's going to be you reaching out to others. Let's go to the next slide and think about these steps. You're going to have to build a realistic budget. Okay, you're going to have to talk to everybody you know and ask them to invest in you as a way of investing in their community. And then you're going to have to do it over and over again. And this comment is so true. You know, the first yes, you're going to be thrilled. You're going to feel empowered. But the first no and the many no's are going to bring you down. But as we all know, people have different relationships with their money at different point in time. So maybe somebody can't give you money, but they can give you their hours or some kind of contribution in kind. Next slide. Here's a sample. There are so many sample budget worksheets out there. Here's one that I just pulled off the internet, but there are many, many different types. And of course, there are consultants out there that can help you with finances, but you're going to have to track it. Some recommend that you go week to week, not month to month. So think about how you want to keep track of your expenditures. And this is just a good one because it gives you a sense of all the types of things you could be spending money on. Let's go to the next slide. Here's a sample candidate disclosure form that I just pulled out. And you can see this individual loaned themselves money. And that's what you might elect to do. You might say, to get started, I need a base of funds. And so I'm going to loan myself money. And of course, you got to think about that filing fee too. Let's go to the next slide. And then, of course, this slide has a long quote on it. But what's important is that from the very beginning, you're thinking about how you're going to get your voters to the polls. It's, you know, registering voters is just one step. Motivating them to literally show up and vote for you, however they vote, is a whole other step. And what this quote is getting at is that who votes matters. It matters. So if you really want people like yourself electing you, make sure you're tapping your networks and reminding those people to go out and vote for you. Because as we all know, for local elections, I mean, it can be as low, you know, 10%, 11% of eligible voters are actually voting. So make sure you're thinking about getting out the vote from the very beginning, and you're always saving money for that step. And the next slide, you know, it's been this adage has been true forever. That personal touch goes a long way, goes a very long way. So you've got to think about your ego, you know, the time you have to knock on doors, just to go to events, to take those precious minutes to make that, that personal conversation will go a long way. The next slide. Think about attending a boot camp. They're all over the place. This is big money now. Electioneering is big money. And so all sorts of people have moved into this space. Now, some have really are committed to making it a learning space. And others are, you know, this is their business. They hope to get your money. And of course, their reputation is based on the number of candidates who win. But really think about that. Explore. There are some that are geared just for women, young people, conservatives, liberals. There are all flavors of boot camps. So I recommend you really take some time and look at some of them that are free on the web. There are handbooks out there too. And they're there to help you. Let's go to the next slide. And, you know, most candidates that go out for the first time, they don't win. They don't. But so are you ready to lose? Do you have thick enough skin? Are you ready to learn? Because we know, and this is particularly true for women, women will run again. And actually, I was looking at some data from Rutgers. For both Democrats and Republicans who won this cycle, and there were more women in this cycle than ever before, that's increasing, they had run before. They had run before. So keep that in mind. Running is a way to learn. look, you'll come in contact with people like Isaac and the League and all sorts of people. You'll learn a lot. And it's still a way to hold incumbents accountable for the issues that you're concerned about. Let's go to the next slide. A little bit of a, just a cartoon. You can feel so up, and then come election, that can happen. But for the final slide here, so if you're not ready, one more slide. If you're not ready, there are a lot of things to do. You can volunteer for somebody you respect, work on their campaign, join the League of Women Voters, watch those. Hey, you can spend time, you can watch City Council from the comfort of your couch. You can watch Mount Pleasant, Folly Beach, City of Charleston. There's so much politics you can watch. And of course, the hearings in the State House and the State Senate, you can spend time watching them and watching how they go about their business. So again, you're more prepared. You'll see how dependent they are on staff people actually to do the grunt work and preparing issues for votes, which is a very important point to remember. But take the time to watch. Maybe get involved with something locally. Learn. So it's okay if you're not ready now. There's a lot of time to learn. And then I have a cartoon on the last slide. Kind of brings us full circle. What? Another election? Are you kidding? But that means we have, as I showed you at the very opening slide, there are a lot of offices that need people who are passionate about issues. And so now we have a little bit of time to take questions, and not only for me, but maybe if Isaac is still around. And I hope I got you feeling more grounded as you think about this decision. That was my goal, is to help you feel grounded and feel prepared.
Thank you, Jerry, so much. We have a couple questions about the PowerPoint. People are interested in having a copy of that. So we'll discuss and send out information to all the participants that are in our database about that. I think, Lane, I think we have time for like one question, and we appreciate your attendance today and staying with us. We think the information presented is very good, but any questions that people might have?
We gave them a lot to think about, no doubt.
Paula, I'm not seeing any questions in my chat box. Do you see anything?
Well, I think, you know, between Isaac and the information I shared, people, I think the League has done a great service for everybody, and just giving them some of the basics, you know, to help. So they feel that they can have the conversations that they need to have, that they won't. And remember, though, that there's no dumb question. There is never a dumb question, especially when you're asking someone who's currently in the office. You should be able to contact them and say, hey, tell me what you're doing. What issues? Can you work on the issues you're passionate about? Who helped you, et cetera, et cetera.
We thank you. Lane Morgan is going to give us our closing. Go for it, Elaine. I've put up the contact information.
I am thrilled, okay? And I can't tell you how much I know that the League and the Chamber appreciates Jerry and Isaac for joining us today and sharing this great information. And we'll try to get that information out on our different webs and everything. And I look forward with the League. And again, we are nonpartisan encourage people to get more involved in government and to vote and do a and be informed about what you're voting for. And this is going to be a great year to get everybody out because it's a lot of people are running in things. So if you have any questions, contact us. Let us know if we can help you in any way. And stay tuned for the next session later this year, hopefully. And have a safe and great weekend. And with that, everybody, thank you. Take care. Bye.
Thank you.